On October 23rd, 1997, in a chamber of government with a 750-year history, something new took place. There had never been a black woman admitted to the House of Lords until now.
I, Valerie, Baroness Amos, do swear by Almighty God that I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth.
It was a day on which a number of people came up to me, welcomed me to the Lords.
So help me God.
From a personal point of view, I felt the importance, really, in terms of recognition of what the black community has achieved in the UK, a kind of recognition that we have skills, experience, expertise that we can actually bring to a place like the House of Lords.
The ceremony was symbolic of the hopes and ambitions of those who had made the voyage on the Empire Windrush nearly 50 years before. Yet at the start of the 80s, the flames in Brixton streets had cast doubt on whether their children would ever find a place in British life. The story of the last two decades is of a battle to belong, a battle for acceptance, a battle to be British. The 1980s opened with a chain of riots which pitted a generation of young black people against the law of the land. In April 1980, a drugs raid in the St. Paul's area of Bristol touched off a day of rioting that left the city shaken. But St. Paul's was to be dwarfed by events just 1 year later in South London. On April 11th, 1981, a police operation against street crime sparked the worst civil unrest seen on British streets this century.
The fires, the cars being turned over. Vividly, what I can clearly remember, right, was just the kind of angriness of the community.
During the next 3 days of mayhem, 226 people were injured and property worth £6.5 million was destroyed. Mike Nesbitt spoke for many.
People have been suppressing the feeling inside them for a very long time. When you have a police come about, like, and make the situation tense, right, anything could happen. And as what happened last night, right? Okay, something triggered off last night, but this is not the first and this will not be the last.
You needed to vent your frustration. Unfortunately, it had to be that way. You know, but to be honest, when you have frustration building up in you, it's either you go out and you scream or you punch out. And it, bang, it exploded.
I have never seen such complete destruction. Brixton looked like those photographs of peasant London. You know, when Brixton had fields and stuff, and dirt roads and stuff, that's what it looked like. To me, the place was completely devastated. And not only that, it went to every black community in Britain.
Throughout the summer of 1981, inner cities across Britain erupted into flames. The chain reaction spread to Liverpool, Birmingham, Manchester, and Leeds. In Liverpool alone, the damage was estimated at some £15 million, more than double the costs in Brixton. By July, what had started as a spontaneous cry of rage had become an organised demonstration.
From Oldham, where we were, we saw that the rest of the country was going up in flames. And of course, on the old grapevine, you know, it's Manchester tonight. And we must have made about 16 trips or so. I remember some horrendous number of trips down to Manchester because the grapevine said, it's tonight, everybody, blah, blah, blah. And you would actually have traffic jams getting into Moss Side as people turned up relentlessly and said, oh, no, no, it's not tonight, lads. And then you'd all troop off home and think, and then it just exploded. And when it exploded, those police had to run for their lives. I mean, they scuttled out of there very quickly indeed, because it was just an overwhelming number of people.
A bewildered Briton asked just one question. Why?
People were crying out to say help. You know, people were crying out for help. People were crying out to say, come down here and look at us down here, for Christ's sake. Come and find out what is happening to us. We are here. We want to be law-abiding citizens, but we are not allowed to live the way a human being should live. We were crying out to the politician. We weren't appealing to the police because the police weren't going to listen. We weren't appealing to our employer. They weren't going to listen. We weren't appealing to the councils because they weren't going to listen. That was their agenda. We were appealing to the government to come and change things for us.
When you burn down your community, you're only harming yourself. But what happened at the time, right, there was so much angerness, so much bitterness, so much annoyance from a community, they didn't care what they burnt down. They wanted replies, they wanted answers.
I think it began to become clear that those young people weren't going to accept the way in which they were being treated. And I think that a lot of older people quietly behind the scenes supported the young people in what they were doing because they felt that they had tried all ways of trying to get justice, and justice wasn't forthcoming.
The causes of the riots had been plain to see in the bleak landscape of the inner cities, poverty, unemployment, and conflict with the police. Margaret Thatcher's Conservative government, which had set up major inquiries into the riots, soon found itself compelled to confront these issues.
Flames in Brixton, the destruction in Toxteth. Oh, one felt, goodness, this shouldn't happen in Britain. But good did come out of it because it took a riot to wake people up and to get quicker action going.
The government's approach to reviving the inner cities was vintage Thatcherism. First, a rallying cry to patriotism, followed by a dose of free enterprise.
Hi, I'm Richard Daly, pleased to meet you. And this is what you call one of the designer shoes.
Richard Daly was exactly the sort of entrepreneurial success that the government hoped for. His chain of sportswear shops demonstrated the go-getting spirit that flourished across Britain in the 1980s.
Mrs. Thatcher, she was a very strong leader, extremely good for the country. She gave a lot of encouragement to people like myself, obviously, who were starting up in business, and gave you the enthusiasm to feel that you can obviously go on and achieve great things. I mean, it really boils down to the individual.
Mrs. Thatcher's enterprise culture and black hustling are sort of cousins under the skin, you know. They really say, carve it out for yourself, you know, open it up. And what I think is, you know, X is wonderful about lots of the, it's a minority only, of course. Everybody's not successful. I don't want to overdo this in any way. But what is marvelous about that minority of black kids that have managed to move into some of these spaces is their tremendous confidence.
A few profited from the enterprise culture, but it passed the majority by. Most of the Windrush generation who had arrived in the 50s and 60s had worked in the public sector all their lives. Their children, if they found work at all, had gone the same route. But just months after the riots, a small group of black and Asian activists in the North London borough of Brent opened a new approach to the problem. They set out to seize control of the area's largest single employer, the local council.
I convinced my management committee, the Community Relations Council, that we ought to become involved in mounting a voters' registration campaign. I then spent a lot of my evenings and afternoons and weekends going around the betting shops and the pubs where I know black people got cane. It was extremely successful. We got rid of a local Tory control and put it in the Labour Party control. I know from my own immediate soundings that we had pretty close to a 90% or thereabouts turnout of the black vote, all around Brent.
Seeley and his allies now set about translating black votes into political power. By 1986, Brent had elected the first black woman council leader in Britain and set in train a radical equal opportunities policy.
We had the council for the first time ensuring that the employment policies were of such that brought black people in rather than kept them out, and that went from top to bottom. More particularly than that, we had a black community out there who felt that for the first time there was not just hope, but things were beginning to happen.
Across the river on London's South Bank, the 1981 elections had brought a new set of politicians to the Greater London Council. They were only too willing to follow Brent's example. And led by future Brent MP Ken Livingstone, they quickly decided on a target. Among the GLC's 21,000 employees, a third were in the fire brigade. Of that 7,000, just six were black. Firemen's jobs were not widely advertised. Vacancies were usually filled by a fireman's relative or friend. The new GLC placed ads in job centres and specifically targeted black candidates. One of the first such recruits was later to become better known as Saracen, the Gladiator. Then he was just another unemployed youngster.
I turned up at Balham Job Centre and there they were, the Equal Opportunities Department from the London Fire Brigade, and we were filling some forms and stuff, and basically that's where I was recruited. I was overjoyed. I mean, 2.5 years unemployed. I was ecstatic, you know, and I was given a chance to actually work.
In just 3 years, the number of black firefighters rose from 6 to 120.
I'll sit off first.
But as it dawned that firefighters themselves would no longer decide who got the jobs, resistance to the GLC's policies grew.
I can particularly remember visiting their training school and being taken into the smoke tunnel, watching people in a tunnel full of smoke doing a fire exercise, and being told at least 30 times that you do realise that it's a life and death matter if you're the fireman at the front and the guy behind you's holding the hose. You need to be able to trust them because their life is in your hands. And the clear message there was that if the guy behind you was black, you wouldn't be able to trust them.
In the old days, we sort of understand it to be that it was a family thing, you know, fathers and sons joining the job. Now you're having an outside force come in, which means that you're taking the job away from my son. And it frightened people, you know. They wanted jobs for their sons, which is understandable. But at the same token, we need jobs too. Yeah.
But black recruits were only half of the GLC's equal opportunities reform. They wanted to see women firefighters too.
I'm in no doubt now that the quantum leap from 6 to 120 black firefighters can be linked to the fact that the fire brigade knew that the GLC was serious about women. And women became a much bigger threat. You know, you might just about imagine having a black man saving your life behind you, but a woman, forget about it.
But the equal opportunities policies promoted by the local councils ran into political trouble from the start. Their supporters were lampooned by the media as loony lefties.
Ken Livingstone infuriated Mrs. Thatcher by using county hall money to finance organisations like the London Lesbian and Gay Centre and the English Collective of Prostitutes. There are GLC committees concerned with ethnic minorities and criticising the police.
The press seized on the excesses of the local council's anti-racist policies, ridiculing decisions like Haringey's banning of the nursery rhyme, Bar Bar Black Sheep. For a Labour Party leadership with its eyes fixed on the victory at the next election, the link between Labour and loony leftism was a disaster. So when black activists came up with a new idea to boost their influence in the party, the stage was set for a confrontation.
I remember on a Saturday afternoon in Walworth Road, black sections were founded. And I remember we had the meeting in the morning, and there were black members of Militant who came and disrupted the whole thing, had a vote not to have black sections. And I can remember in the afternoon, Paul Button came in, and he actually said what went on in the morning. He said, oh, well, everybody was quite discouraged. And he said, oh, to hell with that, let's have another vote. And by that time, Militant had gone, and we won the vote.
In the 1983 general election, almost 9 out of 10 black voters supported Labour. But there were no black MPs. The Black Sections movement argued that black voters were being taken for granted.
We've
been accused of apartheid, right? I'll tell you what's apartheid. All white parties and multiracial constituencies, that's apartheid. And all white House of Commons, that's apartheid. We are providing a remedy for this apartheid, and there are no practical alternatives coming forward.
For too long, what had characterised the Labour Party was a kind of paternalism towards black people. Characteristically, white people in the Labour Party liked black people the further they were away. So if you're a little black baby in South Africa, wonderful, marvellous. If you're a starving black man in Somalia, quite good. But if you're a black person living up the road in Brixton, uh-oh.
The question we have to ask is whether the way of improving on our past performance is the creation of separate black sections. And it is the view of the executive that the answer to that question is a resounding no.
When the demand for a black section was placed before the Labour Party conference, it was swiftly rejected. For much of the Labour leadership, the scheme smacked of racial separatism. Even more important, they believed that it would be unpopular with white voters and be cited as yet another example of left-wing extremism.
And anyone who conducts this debate in a way which damages the prospects of the Labour government damages the black and Asian British more than they damage anybody else.
What was a mistake was to have allowed it to have become hijacked by the far left. It was quite understandable and quite proper and quite legitimate to say that the Constitution ought to reflect more the membership of the party. What was sad was the way that it all got caught up in that whole leftish sectarian battle that was at that time going on within the Labour Party.
We go now as tribunes.
Socialism. In 1987, the first black MPs were elected to Parliament. All three of them had been involved in the Black Sections campaign. Even though the campaign had not won its demands, the climate within the Labour Party was shifting.
Once I was selected for a safe Labour seat, I had a reasonable prospect of getting elected, but the selection was much more difficult. And what I put to Hackney Labour Party people on the night was that, you know, the world had changed. And if they looked around them in areas like Hackney, the population had changed, and they had to make a decision that night which looked to the future, and that I was that decision.
For the first time, the descendants of the Windrush Voyagers could claim a voice at the highest levels of British democracy. But it was an advance for the few rather than the many.
The paradox of the riots in Brixton and elsewhere is they didn't do much the youth that rioted. Money poured into Brixton subsequently, but hardly any of it went into the pockets of black people who really helped to rebuild those communities. Didn't do much for them. But what it did do, at the kind of, you know, at the darkest night of Thatcherism, if you like, it set off a debate around race and black representation, of which people like myself became members of parliament.
Even as the political struggles were being fought out in the conference halls, a familiar battle was being played out in the streets. In autumn 1985, a second wave of riots rocked the country. Their ferocity was even greater than before, and focused on one target, the police.
When they kick at your front door, how you gonna come? With your hands on your head, or on the trigger of your gun?
At Broadwater Farm, the murder of a policeman shocked the country. The Brixton disturbances began after Cherry Gross had been shot by police. Broadwater Farm was triggered by Cynthia Jarrett's death from a heart attack while police raided her home. Of all the authorities from whom action was demanded after the 1981 disturbances, the police, it seemed, had been the slowest to change.
It was pretty bad because the police hadn't adjusted to the realities of multiracial society as quickly as they should. They'd got their own fairly hard-set ways of doing things, which they should have been modifying.
Policing has remained a flashpoint for more than two decades. A series of deaths in custody and unsolved racial murders have deepened the mistrust. But nothing has illustrated the gulf between black families and the police as starkly as the event surrounding the death of a young student in southeast London in April 1993.
Stephen Lawrence was waiting at a bus stop in Eltham at about 10:30 last night. Not far away, he and a friend were approached by a gang of up to half a dozen white youths who subjected them to racial abuse. Stephen, who was training to be an architect, was stabbed twice and died later in hospital.
No, it was just like a bad dream. That one minute your child's alive, the next minute they're telling that he's dead. And how did he die? Why did he die? I think up until now I still have difficulty in believing that Stephen is gone.
To his family and friends, the killing of Stephen Lawrence in an area notorious for the activities of far-right groups seemed to have an obvious motive. But the local police had another theory.
They didn't care. That was the attitude I felt. All they were interested in is trying to say that Stephen was a bad person, he deserved what he got. And, you know, these people didn't just stab him just for the sake of it, but there had to be some gang, some fight, some something.
My view is that the police just saw another black person dead and didn't bother. What they were more concerned about was he involved in some sort of illegal dealings with drugs or whatever goes through their mind when a black person is a victim of a crime is still beyond me.
But the accounts of Stephen's family and friends, black and white, painted a picture of a law-abiding, hard-working churchgoer who had never been involved in anything shady. 5 white youths were eventually charged with his murder, but the trial collapsed due to a lack of prosecution evidence. The accused men walked free.
Came out looking very confident that they've seemed as if they believe that they've beat the system, that they've got away with murder. And there was nothing anybody can do about it.
The failure to bring anyone to book over the Stephen Lawrence killing carried echoes of a case 12 years earlier when 14 black teenagers had died as a result of a house fire in Deptford. There too, the black community had been convinced that a racial attack had been ignored by the police. But this time, the public response could hardly have been more different. Whereas at Deptford, the lack of public and official support had left the victims' families feeling isolated and angry, the Lawrences found themselves backed by a wave of public sympathy. The Daily Mail campaigned for the families, printing the pictures of the five alleged killers and daring them to refute the charge in public. Those who had been through both tragedies could feel the change.
People identified Stephen with their own son, which is not often the case when it's a black person. And that was where the difference was. We were still aliens during the fire. So I'm not sure the police had changed, but I think there was a lot of people in the community who had moved on and were absolutely shocked to learn of Stephen's death. People still stop me in the street and say, oh, I wish there was something I can do.
I think we receive hundreds of letters and cards, and apart from the odd few, everybody was very, very concerned, very sympathetic, and a lot of them took pains to say that, you know, this is from a white woman, this is from a white man, to show that, you know, it doesn't matter what race that they are, they can still feel the same, or try to feel the same pain as what we are feeling.
The Lawrence case highlighted the change in attitude since the early 80s. Stephen Lawrence was a national tragedy, a long way from the days when all black people were automatically treated as foreigners.
Have you been over here long?
Yes, I'm here from March.
The distance travelled is nowhere more obvious than in television. The arrival of the first generation of West Indian migrants coincided with the growth of British television in the 1940s. The medium has both reflected and played a part in changing attitudes.
Good evening.
Good afternoon.
We just have to look at television. But people are part of the society now. They've got Trevor MacDonald and Maurice Short, and everywhere you turn, things have changed considerably. For my day, things have changed.
But let's hear first of all from Cy Grant.
The market strike is over today. Mr. Frank Cousins has had his way, but he ran into a lot.
Cy Grant was the first black face to make an impression on British viewers when he became a regular performer on the BBC's long-running nightly show, Tonight.
I'm surprised they didn't throw tomatoes about. Blocks have got rotten since they came out. We're bringing you the news you ought to know.
I remember Cy Grant, yeah. He was one of the few black people that were on television in the 60s that you would stop and listen to. But there weren't very many British black people doing it. When I was growing up, there weren't very many role models, apart from American people, to sort of aspire to.
In the 50s and 60s, it was rare to see a black artist on TV. Even for a big name like Cy Grant, opportunities were scarce after The Tonight Show ended.
There were very few roles. Black people were, in those days, were not policemen or lawyers or doctors. They did not exist. So the roles that you played had to reflect your role in society. So it was very limited role. There was nothing like integrated casting. There were no kind of black producers or directors in television.
Where black performers did appear, their roles were all too often negative or belittling.
I remember I liked The Goon Show, and there's a guy called Ray Ennington who had an orchestra, and he played the break in the middle of The Goon Show. And when they introduced him, I always remember Peter Sellers and Spike Milligan used to go, and here comes that crazy chocolate-covered goon, Ray Ennington. Well, what kind of talk is that? You know, you'd be enjoying the show, and they'd say something like that. You can imagine how it made you feel.
Belly to belly, I don't give a damn, cos I done dead already. Back to back, belly to belly at the zombie jamboree.
2, 3, zombie. I also remember the black guy in The Spinners. He was astounding. I did a joke about him in the last show I did, that he was there with his finger stuck in his ear singing, you know, dance, dance, wherever you may be. I am the lord of the dance, said he. You know, every so often they'd let him sing the West Indian song or do the Anansi story or something. Oh, for God's sakes, you know. Just once I wanted to grab the mic and say, ah, shot the sheriff. But knowing him, he'd have probably gone, no, go no more. A sheriff shooting, sheriff shooting, sheriff shooting.
Back to back, belly to belly at the zombie jamboree.
Last time now.
Back. You know, it's very difficult, I think. People needed to be shown that there was a possibility that you could do something. And I think that's what whole generations were waiting for, the ticket.
Mr. Charlie Williams.
In 1971, at a time when the climate towards black people was at its most hostile, a British-born black comedian emerged.
I've also had a Yorkshire accent, because born and bred here. Won't call it blackface, but coloured. And it took off. And people were saying, aren't you that darkie? He talks right broad Yorkshire. So it sounded twice as funny with a Yorkshire accent.
Good afternoon, my flowers! right colour, wrong accent.
I think it was a huge culture shock for people. And Charlie exploited it to the full. You know, he was the king of comedy for a while, and God bless him, good luck to him. Because at the time, nobody was doing what he was doing. He was playing the kind of fat belly, bigoted northern comedian at their own game.
Is that in colour? I hope it is. If it's in black and white, you've got a negative.
That joke was made out of, look, I'm aware that this is what some white people think, so I'm going to say it first before you guys say it. I just think it was the times and you did what you had to do to survive in a predominantly white world.
Charlie Williams' success opened the door for a new generation of black comics. One of them, a teenager from Dudley in the West Midlands. From strength to
strength. This boy is on his 16 years of age. Talented, house-trained, and very, very funny. Ladies and gentlemen, it's got to be Lenny Henry.
All you saw was a guy leaning over a pram, a huge fella leaning over a pram, and you heard Frank Spencer's voice coming out of him. And then he turned round, and he was Lenny Henry. And he was a black... And you thought, oh, well, there's an instant shock.
I'll fix it later.
You know, I think 12 or 13 million people saw this black kid doing these sort of half-funny jokes. But the hook was, wow, he's black, he's really young, and he's... Maybe he's got some. Maybe this kid's got something. What do you think? What do you say? Give him a chance. Give the kid a chance.
He wasn't a university comic. He wasn't a middle-class comic. He was a working-class kid from Dudley. And he learned his trade on the Black and White Minstrels.
So they built a town around him.
People in Britain watched this show and nobody ever mentioned that these people were blacked up. It was always, oh, aren't the songs lovely? And, ooh, look at those costumes. And aren't those sets great? And people were pissed off about it, sure. But it was, people go, oh, what? This is not a racial show. This show isn't a racial issue. They're just great songs. Nobody ever faced up to this fact of, well, why are all these guys blacked up? What's going on there?
Dreaming of a white Christmas.
You got no chance.
I was a young guy. I was like 17, 18 when I was doing the show. And every so often, it was like I was splitting to two on my shoulder with this thing of, you know, there's a fundamental problem with you being in the show, don't you, Len? And the other side were going, oh, just take the money and have a great time, you know. But this voice on my right shoulder just got bigger and bigger until eventually I couldn't live with it anymore.
And then he went on and did Tis Was, which really did cement him. And he was under those brilliant impressions. He was Trevor McDonagh.
It's just been announced from Stockholm that Vladimir Kurtz, the Russian bell ringer, who was exiled for ringing his church bells all through the night, has been awarded this year's No Peace Bell Prize.
Yeah. Trevor McDonagh was a perfect vehicle for them because he was on the news and he was the only black newsreader at the time. And it was great! Yeah. And I would watch him and I would... It was just... He had a little smile that he did of news reports, and he had a little head inclination that he did. And this, and that, and the other. Jeff McDonald, he was at 10, London, you know, and he had this thing. And I just thought, this is a really, he's a great bloke, a great character.
But the big prize of the night, the gold medal, went to Trevor McDonald.
As Lenny Henry rose to become Britain's favourite comedian, Trevor McDonald became the nation's favourite newscaster.
Since that time, it's been unusually quiet here. The view is gaining ground here, that we might be witnessing the beginning of the end.
That's news at 10 tonight. We're here again tomorrow. I sometimes feel that I have achieved almost nothing on my own, and that almost...
As black faces became a familiar part of the television landscape, another arm of popular culture was experiencing something new. The music industry, used to importing black Americans, discovered a black British voice. In 1989, Soul to Soul emerged. With just two songs, Keep On Moving and Back to Life, they sold nearly 3 million records worldwide.
To me, the moment of Soul to Soul was about saying to the population of black people in other parts of the world, particularly in America, that a black English culture was operating, that was convincing on its own terms. It was the first time that a sound had been born here, which was not that was not traceable back to a copy.
By the end of the 80s, their sound had come to define British pop for a generation.
I think Soul to Soul's music is an eclectic mix of Euro, colonial, because it really has the whole traces of European pop elements laced with, I think, the very essence of, like I would say, roots music, reggae background, etc., etc. So what we tried to do was bring the whole lot in together, turning the whole ideology of being British really in our favour.
This wasn't the first time that black British artists had made an impact on the market, but it was the first time that an internationally successful black act had been recognised as British. The first rumblings of an authentic black British sound had come from a band called The Equals. The three black and two white members broke new ground in their style. Their music was essentially American soul with a cheeky English twist. But from The Equals emerged a performer who would point a new direction for black artists in Britain, Eddie Grant.
Whoa, mama, you're gonna burn me in the wrong time.
As a solo reggae artist, Grant achieved more hits than any previous black British singer. He set up his own label and marketed and distributed his work. It was his example that led indirectly to the first authentically black British pop sound. The thriving dance halls of the UK reggae scene depended on a network of sound system DJs. Learning from Grant, the DJs used their profits to produce records which they then sold through dances. The DJs needed singers. In East London, they found dozens of young women singing in churches and talent contests. The music they invented would become known as Lover's Rock. One of its stars was Carol Thompson.
Strange, so strange that I am feeling.
They were pop songs set to light reggae music. And at that time, it was more almost like a backlash against the roots side, the Bob Marley culture, Burning Spear. You heard things like, "Do you remember the days of slavery?" And then I'd come out with something like "Hopelessly in Love." Hopelessly in love. It's very lightweight and very romantic, and it was essentially very British, as opposed to trying to sound Jamaican or from the Caribbean.
Janet Kay's chart hit Silly Games showed that there could be a market for lover's rock outside the dance halls, but major record companies showed little interest. Though lover's rock faded into obscurity, it laid foundations for a generation of black British musicians. Soul to Soul, in their turn, opened the way for a wave of singers and songwriters who had put themselves at the heart of British pop. Even the most successful still have reservations about the nature of their success.
If the Soul to Soul came up tomorrow, which was white, they'd probably do far better than Soul to Soul Black in this country. Without a doubt. They go get everything.
We could name millions of groups that have come up within the last year. And you know you've seen a black group that's exactly the same and maybe even twice as talented. You know, at the end of the day, if you're a group and you've sold as many albums as the other group and you've had as many singles as the other group and the other group's on the front cover and you're not, you think the only difference is that we're black and they're white. And it's very different. Frustrating.
If even those who appear to have broken through still doubt their acceptance, is there any chance that black people can truly regard themselves as British? One answer lies here in the fiercely nationalistic arena of our national game.
And it's Barnes.
This scene would have been unimaginable in the 40s for players like Charlie Williams, a football pro with Doncaster Rovers, long before he found fame as a comedian.
I enjoyed my footballing days. Thought they were great. When I ran out, no matter whether there were 40 spectators or 30 or 4,000, they all went, "Oh, there's a darkie playing." And I used to wonder, I'm human. But it wasn't said in any malice. It was just amazement. Because in them days, there weren't many coloured footballers. Little did I realise that within 20 years, they'd be dominated by coloured players.
In the 1970s, the few black footballers who broke through into the professional game were far from welcome.
The most difficult place to have gone to in those times was West Ham. West Ham was very, very hostile, and yet still Clyde Best was there. Very hostile. They spat at you from... Because the way that the you had to walk out of the tunnel, and the way their tunnel was set up, people was right above it, so you'd get spitting coming at you. So, we used to cover up in a plastic mac as we go out in order to avoid getting it in our hairs and on our backs.
My debut for West Brom against Birmingham City was a bit of a wild night, a lot of rain, etc. I ran onto the field, I slipped, I thought it was just a muddy pitch. I looked down and there were bananas on the pitch. We used to get it at West Ham. It made us more determined.
Oh, splendid goal! What a magnificent goal by Batson!
For a while, football turned a blind eye, but by the end of the 70s, a flood of talented black players was making that impossible. Batson, along with Cyril Regis and Laurie Cunningham, formed the backbone of a rising West Bromwich Albion team. But as more black players appeared, the chorus of abuse grew louder.
A lot of booing behind the Ipswich goal by the Ipswich supporters.
People just didn't want you out there. And as we was breaking new ground, you know, it made it important that we could actually cope at the time. And probably if we hadn't coped, there wouldn't be many others there now.
Through the 1970s, the larger clubs who could buy the pick of the professionals ignored black players. Smaller clubs had little choice but to go with local talent, whatever its colour. But in 1979, from one such club emerged a young star who was to become the first non-white player to be picked for England.
I was just so nervous and I just wanted to get on with the game, and I was just really, really focused on trying to play well on the night. And everything else passed by. It's only now, you know, 14, 15 years later, you think there was never a black person been capped before, and that must have helped John Barnes and, you know, Luther Blissett and the other people that came after me.
At a stroke, Anderson's selection destroyed a series of myths that had kept black players out of the top flight.
It was a bit of a whispering campaign about, yeah, you know, they might be athletic and all that, they might be quick, but, you know, they don't really know how to tackle, they don't really know how to defend, they're not disciplined enough when it comes to winter, they don't like training in the cold. All those, you heard it.
When the cold weather comes, they don't perform and this, that and the other. And here comes a skinny little kid from Nottingham who kicks people for a living and plays for England, you know. I broke the mould in that respect.
Well, what a wonderful start. No player eccentric.
Anderson's selection was the start of a trend that saw a transformation in the English game. In 1987, John Barnes became the first black player to be bought by the country's most successful club, Liverpool. Cash came flooding into the game from TV and satellite deals, and clubs were floated on the stock market. The biggest teams became far more interested in the colour of money than in the colour of the players who brought them success.
As the years went by, you saw more and more black kids playing football. And I think it's just a sheer weight of numbers that football couldn't ignore the talent that was available to them. And eventually, that's led to where we are today.
Ferdinand!
By 1995, the three most expensive players in Britain were black. In the same year, Manchester United's Paul Ince captained England.
I can't think of any way, shape or form that black players will not be an integral part of the England setup. They're here to stay. And as I say, you know, you look at Paul Ince, who's captain of the full England team, look what he did in Rome and the acceptance of his role that he played there.
When England qualified for the 1998 World Cup in a grimly fought draw with Italy, black players embodied the team's grit and courage. Paul Ince was the nation's Captain Courageous. Ian Wright was England's Lionheart. In a nation where sport has become the principal expression of national pride, black Britons have become standard bearers.
Thank you.
Multiculturalism is a divisive force. Youngsters of all races born here should be taught that British history is their history. If they are not, they will be forever foreigners holding British passports.
But not every voice is raised in a hymn of praise to multicultural Britain. Last autumn, Lord Tebbit repeated his 1990 warning that black Britons could not be regarded as truly British until they were ready to cheer for England against the West Indies. 8 years ago, it threw the government into confusion. This time, his own leader dismissed it as the ramblings of a dinosaur. Just weeks before the Tebbit speech, William Hague had been out on the streets of Notting Hill. His attitude could not have been clearer.
Well, I've just come to see what happens here at the carnival. It's the biggest cultural event in the nation. I think politicians ought to be out and about here.
What started a generation ago as a largely West Indian event is now a three-day national festival where Caribbean people and their descendants are in a minority on the streets. It is a vivid example of the way that Britain itself has been changed since those first 500 set off on their adventure aboard the Empire Windrush 50 years ago. They came from island colonies with a British flag, a British king, and even British passports.
London, this lovely city. You can go to France or America, India, Asia, or Australia, but you must come back to London City.
You see, back home, we had the foolish saying, we are British. And coming here, I felt British. I knew I wasn't English. Although a lot of black people think they were English because they had English in their mind. But they didn't realize to be English you had to be born here. But I am British and I love the country.
Even those early voyagers who made it back to the Caribbean as they originally intended find themselves longing for what has become their real home. England. If anyone fulfilled the immigrant dream of returning home having made their fortune abroad, it is the multi-millionaire owner of this mansion in Montego Bay. Joe Witter came to Britain in 1954 and over the next three decades amassed a fortune in property. He returned to Jamaica in 1980.
When I come back to Jamaica, it was a little bit funny because I could never get accustomed to this slow movement, you know. You get here and anything you want to get done, you can never get it done today. It's always tomorrow. Oh, that's all right, man, leave it. We'll get it done next week. I get very annoyed. I miss a lot of things about England, you know, in that. And the folks get to know me. I become a part of the English family. They get to love me, I love them, you know, I go anywhere. And it was great. As far as I'm concerned, Britain is my home.
There is little doubt that returnees like Joe Witter have been changed by their time in Britain. Windrush passenger Euton Christian, like most other migrants of his generation, has never returned. For him, Britain, with all its problems and difficulties, has now become a home that the land of his birth can never be.
I've been living in Britain for 54 years. My family were born over here. And as far as Jamaica is concerned, no, I love the country. But to me, to return there to live permanently, it's out of the question, because it's like a strange country. Nobody knows me. and I know nobody.
In the passage of half a century, Britain has changed out of all recognition from the place the original Windrush voyagers discovered. Some of those changes have been made by the Windrush generation, their children and their grandchildren. Their biggest legacy is to have changed for good what it means to be British.
They can only be black and British because what British means has been transformed largely by them. Until two decades ago, Britishness was coded racially and in color terms. Everybody knew to be British meant to be white. You didn't have to say white British because that's what it meant. Well, I don't think it's true. I think you can be who you are, you can be black, you can have come to Englishness or Britishness in the 90s by a very different route from the Caribbean via the colonial relation on the Empire Windrush through migration into the inner city. This is a British history. It's one of the many British histories.
Those of us who are still here feel we're part of Britain. And it will take another bond to change from that attitude, as far as we're concerned.
Yes, I'm British, but whether they allow me to be British, it's another question, isn't it?
I'm cultured through Britishness, if there's such a word. But I am of African West Indian origin. That's what I am. I will never be an English rose. Don't want to be an English rose. But yes, I'm British. If I, you know, I can't deny that.
How do I feel now, whether I'm black or British? I think I'm a bit of both, really. I'm black and I'm definitely British, you know? And that's what I am.
Continuing our celebration of Windrush's 60th anniversary with TV's Black Pioneers at midnight and the Black 18th Century at half past, plus Tales from the Front Room tomorrow at 20 past 10. Back to tonight, though, stay tuned for the many lives of Q.